Have you ever wondered about the pollution in our air and how it affects our gardens and ourselves every day? Well, in this video, we're going to get into it. I just want to say thank you so much to Kenny. He made a great comment and it made me want to talk about it a little bit more. I heard the other day that all the rainfall has microscopic carcinogens in it now because of pollution. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe. And if you've been thinking about joining our membership, I actually have a very unique deal. One of our members' wives has MS. They have found a very unique procedure that will completely rid her body of MS down in Mexico. They are looking right now to raise $45,000 and are about halfway there. If you go over there and donate $5 to $10 and send me over a screenshot at admin@perfectgardens.com, I will give you a 6-month membership over on our private Telegram. If you donate $50, I will double that return and give you 2 months of VIP consulting. If you donate $100, I'll give you 4 months of VIP consulting, doubling that value and that return. Guys and gals, this opportunity to double your return is good up until the campaign gets funded. So let's go ahead and help them out. Get over there, donate some money, send me a screenshot, add me at Perfect Gardens, and let Perfect Gardens hook you up with additional returns. Okay, so what's in our rain, actually, and how does it affect us? Because for me, I grew up in Monterey, California, so whenever it rained, what I would see is I'd see all the mountains turn green, right? And as we got into it, we learned that as the water droplets fall through the sky, it collects nitrogen in that form through the nitrification process and the bacteria, it converts it into usable nitrogen. Although, as that rainfall is dropping, it's probably collecting other things, right? I mean, we're driving, we smoke, all of our industrial revolution of putting pollutions in the air. I mean, all of those particulates, plastics, all these things that evaporate and break down and become water soluble, they go into our atmosphere because they have different densities as they evaporate. So it would make sense that as water is flowing through the sky, they're probably collecting some of that stuff, right? So is it harmful? And the word that normally is thrown around is carcinogens. And what is a carcinogen? Well, a carcinogen is something that creates cancer at some point. Although nowadays, it seems like just about everything can be a carcinogen. I actually included a really great chart that goes from group 1 to group 2A, 2B, 3, and 4, going down from something that will definitely create cancer that is a carcinogen all the way to something that isn't a carcinogen. Obviously, things like smoking and radiation and drinking alcohol every day are things that are definitely going to create a carcinogen experience. They could very well create cancer, and they're known to it, right? Like liver disease, or you're smoking, you have lung disease or lung cancer. All those things is because what did we do there, right? We allowed our addictions to take hold of our life. And same thing, like if we're in a garden and you have a leaf, right? And these leaves are, and let's say you have the leaves on the outside that are exposed to the sun, but a couple leaves on the inside, and you have a real dense, tight internodes. Well, some of those leaves, if you don't open up that airflow, very well can start to create some powdery mildew or some botrytis or anything along those lines, while the stuff on the outside looks great. It's the same thing here. If you expose your body or you expose your plants to the wrong environment or an environment that's not conducive for life, at some point, a carcinogen, a powdery mildew, a botrytis, a fungal disease, something's going to start to set in on your plant, nutrient deficiencies, malnourishment. I'm just using different words they use in plants versus in your own personal individual health, but I'm trying to use them to kind of bring us into a focal point of really what creates cancer. And obviously there are definitely chemicals that can, if you're exposed to them even one time, they can kill you almost instantly, right? But then there are other chemicals that if you're exposed to them too much and for too long, that's when they become carcinogenic. So I'm always trying to alleviate the worry and stress out of people's lives. Like if you live in an environment that's not healthy for you and that's carcinogenic, right? That's toxic, that has free radicals. I use free radicals as bad people or unhealthy relationships or just people that don't build you up. Well, if you continue to keep exposing yourself to that, even if you're alive, you'll begin to start dying sooner in your life. Internally, you can very well develop cancer. There's many stories where people, they got it in their mind that they were sick, and they actually mentally caused their own cancer. And then as they broke that mental thought process, that habit, that story, they became cancer free. So there's a very unique thing around carcinogens, right? It's not just chemicals, but it's also our social environment. Everything around our environment can actually create cancer if we're exposed to it for too long. I could very easily start to go down all the different types of chemicals, asbestos, cadmium, radon, volatile organic compounds caused by the petrochemical industry, plastics that evaporate off, I can start to benzenes, pills we take, all these types of things I can get into, but it's just, that's not really what matters. What really matters is understanding how it happens. And it happens by being in an environment that's outside of the natural order of life for too long. When you're in an environment that is not conducive to blooming life, at some point, because of just being in a destructive environment, it will become carcinogenic and unhealthy for you or for your plants. What do you do about it? How do you stop these carcinogenic properties from building up too much in your environment to create cancer? Because a lot of these, really, most of these are going to be caused by an imbalance of these chemicals in your environment. Even, like I said, chemicals can even be the chemicals that you produce of your own thought process. And as you're putting panic and dumping different chemicals through your pancreas and it's flowing into your system, that can become carcinogenic too. So I'm really trying to loop this all in. So how do you fix this? Well, I know this might sound absolutely crazy, and this is something that I've thought about a lot for the last decade, is how do you naturally create an environment that's not carcinogenic? Like, what are the few things you should have in your environment, whether it's in your body or whether it's you providing it to your plants? What is that thing you provide to your plants and to your body 2, 3, 4, 5 times a day, even whether you're drinking pop or you're drinking coffee? What is that core substance that you're constantly putting into your body that if you didn't have it for 4 or 5 days, there's a good likelihood that you would die? What is that one thing that is constantly flowing through your system? You could survive for a month or longer. I've done it, all right? I've fasted for 28 days, so I know I could survive for 28 days without food. But the one thing I needed to put in my system every single day, or I would have died, was water. This is the same thing with the carcinogens. We have to fix our water. And how do you fix your water? Well, how do you fix your water when, even as you look at it right here, one of the 5 main carcinogens that are in water is actually nitrates? Okay, so how do you fix this carcinogenic environment with water when we need these nitrates, right? I mean, that's what we've been told, to grow our crops and to be healthy, because we still need those nitrogens as we eat our food to break down, because the nitrogens are amino acids. Those are the basic building blocks of our RNA, DNA, and our cellular structure, our proteins, all of that stuff. So how do we create an environment? This is what's been my question for a number of years. How do we create this environment that's more balanced so that, again, the even naturally occurring minerals, if there's too much of them, could create cancer over time? How do we create this environment that's more balanced? I talk about the law of tolerance, law of minimum, right? Well, it comes by, really, there's only a few ways to do it when I look at it with water. Well, you either take your water that's dirty and you purify it through running it through RO systems, or you heat it up and you recollect the water, which creates a distillation process, and then you now have water. So now, what have we done, right? We have fixed our problem by removing the carcinogens out of the water so we can start to drink the water or give it to our plants, and we don't have to deal with that problem. But the issue with that is if we just use the RO or distilled water, it's actually going to start to rob the plant of the minerals. And the water is going to want to start to hold on the minerals, and you're going to start to have a battle between whether it's your plants or whether you're drinking the water. The water is actually going to strip various minerals out of your body, causing malnourishment. It's so funny, right? So then now we have to add something back to the water. Well, what do we add back to the water where it can be balanced? And guys, for some reason, at some point in my life, 13 years ago, I was fortunate enough to have a very close friend hand me a bottle of Drops Balance. And at that point, I've talked about this, we were at the mushroom farm. We had installed a very elaborate water system because there was so much stuff flowing through the pipes and it was killing the plants, and we had to basically take this dirty water and strip it and clean it, filter it. And then at that point we were adding fertilizer. But at that point we were wasting so much water through our filtration process that it became a problem for me mostly than anything else. And especially now, as you see Mead Lake and you see just all the reservoirs draining, and that's becoming a problem, especially with the agriculture, for the agriculture in California and worldwide. The solutions of yesterday may have been feasible, but they're no longer a solution of the problems that we're encountering today. And us using an RO system when they're wasting 4 gallons of water to get 1 gallon of water that's empty and has no viable life that we have to then go back and add things to, which when you look at the stuff that you add to many times, their industrial processes actually create more carcinogens through the process of making the solution, right? Or you go through the distillation process, which requires an enormous amount of energy. And how do you accumulate that energy? Where does that energy come from? Does it come from a clean source, or does it come from a dirty source, which could, once again, create more carcinogens? For me, I was so fortunate to have the solution of Drops of Balance literally just handed and put into my hands. And when I found a product that cleans the water source without wasting any water, it cleans and fixes the carcinogens. It reverts them back to non-detectable, and you can check out the lab testing on dropsofbalance.com. I'm not trying to make another Drops of Balance commercial. It's just the questions you guys keep asking me keep going back down when I just don't want to inform you of the problem, but I also want to provide a solution that's economical, a solution I use in my daily practices. And you know, you put your money where your mouth is, right? And that's what I'm doing, is I put my money where my mouth is. I use this product. When my former wife was pregnant, she'd been on the minerals. She still is on the minerals. Even, it's funny, the things that survived the marriage, right? The minerals, Drops of Balance, survived the marriage. She has continued to keep using it in her water and in her daily life, even if she doesn't really feel very fondly about me at this point still. And it's a joke, but I'm still being kind of serious. It's like, this is one of the primary solutions to the problems that we face now, the problems that we have faced in the past, the problems that we face today, and the problems that we will be facing into the future. Please make sure to use the discount code CLEANWATER when you're at Drops of Balance for additional discount. And if you have any questions, please leave a comment down below in the description. Thanks so much, and have a great girl. Okay, so real quick, as we look at these products, we're going to jump down the very bottom where it says Open Sesame, BC Bloom, and Cha Ching. As you can see right here, that none of these products overlap. You use the Open Sesame first. They recommend 1/4 teaspoon per gallon. Then you jump over to a BC Blooms. And remember, so right now you're in the first 3 weeks into flowering is when you use Open Sesame. And you got to think about it, right? Their marketing is Open Sesame, so starting those flowers. Beastie Blooms is to really get those flowers going, is their marketing thought process. And so for there, you'll use the Beastie Blooms, again, 1/4 teaspoon per gallon for about 2 weeks. So weeks